Previously, we have seen the introduction to ARM and the different processors in ARM, how they have evolved. We have also seen what are the advantages and applications of using ARM Cortex-M3. Today, we will begin with the architecture of ARM Cortex-M3. So whenever we study a processor or a controller, we study its architecture, like what are the different things in that, and those things are required, you know, in order to program a particular microcontroller or processor. So this is the architecture of ARM Cortex-M3. So rather, we call it a simplified view of Cortex-M3 because, you know, when it comes to architecture, it has got different blocks, and here we have the simplified version of that. What we observe is we have this particular processor core. In the processor core, we have ALU, that is arithmetic and logic unit. Then there is a register bank where there are different registers. In the Cortex-M3. Then there is a decoder, which is used to decode the instructions that are fetched. And there is an instruction fetch unit, which fetches the instruction from the memory. And for that, we have the memory interface, which acts as an interface between the processor core system and the memory. There is also an interrupt controller, which is actually a nested vector interrupt controller, which can serve the interrupts, whichever occurs. Then there is a trace interface, which is connected to the debug system, which is used to debug the software or the instructions through trace, that is by tracing each instruction one by one. Then there is the external to the system, we have this code memory, wherein you have the programs written in the memory, then memory system and certain other peripherals and also private peripherals, which are connected to the processor core through the bus interconnect. The bus interconnect or the bus system, you know, it is that connects all these things to the processor core. And also there is a memory protection unit, which is an optional, obviously. There's a memory protection unit. And since it is a Harvard architecture, you have a separate instruction bus and a data bus, which is connected through which, you know, you are communicating from the memory into the processor core. And of course, there's a debug interface for debugging your hardware and software. So this is a brief or simplified view of Cortex-M3. So when you're asked architecture, you can draw the same diagram and explain each block in this. So we will see them one by one. So it is a 32-bit microprocessor. Cortex-M3 is a 32-bit microprocessor. What we mean by 32-bit microprocessor is it can act on 32-bit data at a time. It has got a 32-bit data path where 32-bit data transfer is possible at a time. Okay, so the buses are of 32-bit wide, the registers are of 32-bit, and memory interfaces are also of 32-bit. It has a Harvard architecture. Harvard architecture, you know what it means? It has a separate instruction bus and data bus. So, which allows for pipelining, right? So this allows instructions and data accesses to take place at the same time. The performance of the processor increases because the data accesses do not affect the instruction pipeline, because instructions and data, they move in a different path, different buses. So this results in multiple bus interfaces on Cortex-M3, each with optimized usage and ability to be used simultaneously. So this increases the efficiency of the system, you know, since we have separate instruction bus and data bus. What we mean by separate instruction and data bus, that doesn't mean that, you know, we can have a large memory, because the instruction and data bus, they share the same memory space. It is called a unified memory system. They share the same memory space. That means both instructions and data, they are present in the same memory space. So we can have up to, this can address up to 2^32. That's how much. Since it is 32-bit processor, it can access up to, it can address up to 2^32, that is 4 GB. If you find what is 2^32, it is actually 4 GB of memory space. We can have 4 GB of memory space, which can be addressed by Cortex-M3. So separate instruction and data bus doesn't mean that you can access 4 GB plus 4 GB. You cannot get 8 GB of memory space just because you have separate buses. They share the same unified memory system. That is, in the 4 GB itself, some are instructions and some are data, and they are used to access instructions. They are accessed through instruction and data buses separately, right? And for complex applications that require more memory system features, we have an optional memory protection unit. As you can see, this memory protection unit, it may not be there in all the systems, but in if you are using some complex systems or complex applications where you have to protect some part of the memory from being used by unauthorized access, you know, that you can use memory protection unit. It is possible to use an external cache also if it is required. And here, Cortex-M3, it supports both little endian as well as big endian memory systems. You know what little endian and big endian systems mean, right? So both are supported by this. Also, this Cortex-M3, it includes a number of fixed internal debugging components. These components provide debugging operation supports and features like breakpoints, watch points, you know, which can be used to debug the program. If at all there are any errors in the program, we can find where exactly it is. You know, there are debug features are inbuilt in this, so which makes it easier for the user or the programmer to find the errors and correct them. Along with that, optional components provide debugging features like instruction trace and various types of debugging features. These are optional things. Along with the inbuilt debugging systems, other things can also be there. These are some features of ARM Cortex-M3. It has got a three-stage pipeline design, fetch, execute, decode, you know, three stages of pipeline design. It has got a Harvard bus architecture with unified memory space. That is, instruction and data, they use the same address space. There is no distinction between data memory and code memory. They share the same unified memory space. Then it has 32-bit addressing. Since it is 32-bit processor, it has got 32-bit addressing. That means it supports up to 4 GB of memory space, 2 raised to 32. That is 4 GB of memory space. Then there are on-chip bus interfaces. We can see there are bus interconnect in the chip itself, right? So that is based on AMBA technology. We call it ARM AMBA technology. AMBA stands for Advanced Microcontroller Bus Architecture. That is one of the bus interface technology, which allows pipeline bus operation for higher throughput. Then interrupt controller is also there, on-chip interrupt controller called Nested Vectored Interrupt Controller, NVIC, right? So Nested Vectored Interrupt Controller, which supports up to 240 interrupt requests and from 8 to 256 different priority levels dependent on the actual device implementation. There can be up to 256 interrupt priority levels, and it supports up to 240 external interrupts. External interrupts up to 240 are supported by this NVIC. Then it has support for various features for OS implementation, like a timer, system tick timer, shadowed stack pointer. We're going to see this stack pointer, how it is shadowed and all. It also supports different power features, sleep mode, and various low power features where, you know, power usage can be minimized. It supports an optional MPU, as we have seen, memory protection unit, to provide memory protection features like programmable memory or access permissions control, you know, certain memory features. Support for bit data accesses. There are two bit band regions in the memory. There are two regions where, you know, bit band access is possible. That means you can access individual bits in particular thing. Otherwise, you have to access one word, right? Here, you know, using bit band access, you can access individual bits of particular memory region. Then the option of being used in single processor as well as multi-processor designs. We can use them as independent single processor or multi-processors where there are more than one processors. Along with one processor, we can use many processors together. That is called multi-processor system. This can be used either as a single processor or as a multi-processor in both of the situations. So we will see each of the things in the architecture one by one. The first thing we have, and very important thing, is the registers. There are different types of registers in Cortex-M3, and you know, there are, you know, registers, you can call them general purpose registers. So actually there are registers from R0 to R15 and also certain special registers, right? So R0 to R15, that means 16 registers. Out of them, 13 registers, R0 to R12, are called general purpose registers. R13 is the stack pointer, R14 is the link register, and R15 is the program counter. So we will see them one by one. R0 to R12, we call them general purpose registers. So these are the different registers. So R0 to R12, they are the general purpose registers. Out of them, 8 registers, R0 to R7, are called low registers, and R8 to R12 are called high registers. And each register is 32-bit wide. It can store 32-bit data, each register. Okay. And R13 is the stack pointer. R13 is the stack pointer. We call it a banked stack pointer. That means there are two stack pointers in Cortex-M3. One is main stack pointer, another one is process stack pointer. Main stack pointer is MSP, process stack pointer is PSP. At a time, one of them is used, other one is banked. You can call it banked or shadowed stack pointer. Then R14 is the link register, R15 is the program counter. So these are the different registers in ARM Cortex-M3. So the first part, that is R0 to R7, is the low registers. All the general purpose registers, they are 32-bit general purpose registers used for certain data operations. R0 to R7 are called low registers. So these low registers, they are called low because they are in the lower order, R0 to R7. They can be accessed by all 16-bit thumb instructions and all 32-bit thumb 2 instructions. Okay, that means they can be accessed by all the instructions, 16-bit as well as 32-bit thumb and thumb 2 instructions. So these registers are all 32 bits. Okay, all the registers are 32 bit wide. The reset value of this is unpredictable. When you reset the microcontroller or processor, what value will be there in this is unpredictable. We do not know. Okay, some random values or jump values will be there. Then R8 to R12, these five registers, R8 to R12, they are called high registers. They are accessible by all thumb 2 instructions, but not by all 16-bit thumb instructions. That means all thumb 2, 32-bit thumb instructions can access these R8 to R12, but not all 16-bit thumb instructions can access this. These are again 32-bit wide. The reset value is again unpredictable. Means we do not know what the reset value may be. Then the register R13 is the stack pointer. We said Cortex-M3 has got two stack pointers, but they are used by the same name, R13 or SP. Okay, they are at the same place. They are banked so that only one is visible at a time. Only one of them is visible at a time. So this duality allows two separate stack memories to be set up. There are two separate stack memories for two different stack pointers. And the lowest two bits of the stack pointers are always zero. Lowest two bits are zero means what stack pointer actually indicates is the starting address of the stack memory. So what contains in the stack pointer is the starting address of the stack memory. If the lowest order are two bits, that means it is always word aligned. So this stack pointer, what are the two stack pointers available? We said there are two stack pointers. One is the main stack pointer. Another one is process stack pointer. The main stack pointer, we call it MSP. That is by default stack pointer. Okay, by default, this will be the stack pointer, MSP. So this is used by the OS kernel, operating systems kernel, then exception handlers. Whenever certain exceptions or interrupts happen, while handling that, it will be main stack pointer that is used. And all the applications, application codes that require privileged access. Okay, so there are two access levels. We will see that. For privileged access, you know, we will use, the system uses this main stack pointer as the default stack pointer. It's also called SP underscore main or main stack pointer. Another stack pointer is the process stack pointer, PSP or SP process. This is in the user access level, that is used by user application code or base level application code when the system is not running an exception handler. For user programs or for user applications, this will be the stack pointer used, process stack pointer. So when we use the register name R13 in the instructions, if you use R13, we can only access the current stack pointer. Current stack pointer means whatever it is there at present, not the banked one. When we are using it as main stack pointer, process stack pointer will be banked or shadowed. If you are using it as process stack pointer, main stack pointer will be banked or shadowed. If you use the name R13, then you can use whatever is being currently the stack pointer. The other one is inaccessible unless we use some special instructions. Okay, there are special instructions to operate on the special registers, that is MSR and MRS. We are going to see them later. So if you want to access the other stack pointer than the current stack pointer, you will have to use these special instructions, MSR and MRS. So this is the operation of how stack memory is implemented, a basic thing using push and pop. So whenever you have studied a microcontroller, or even in a computer organization, you have studied this push and pop operations. When you stack memory, the contents are put into the stack memory using push operation, and to get the contents from the stack memory into the registers, we use pop operation, right? So there is a adjustment in the stack pointer whenever you push the contents into the stack and take it out of the stack. The stack is first in, last out buffer. As you know, whatever comes in first, it goes out last, or whatever comes in last, it goes out first. So there is adjustment in the value of the stack pointer. Whenever you push the contents into the memory, into the stack memory, contents of stack pointer is decremented by 4, and then you put it into the memory, right? And whenever you pop it, contents pointed by stack pointer are copied into the registers, and then, you know, stack pointer is incremented by 4. Why? Because this is a 32-bit microcontroller or processor, right? 32-bit means it is 4 bytes. That's why it is in memory. Each location can store 8-bit data. So for 32-bit, we require 4 bytes or 4 memory locations. That's why whenever you push the data into the stack memory, stack pointer is decremented by 4, and when you pop, stack pointer is incremented by 4. So those things you are not going to perform, but it is adjusted automatically. Okay, these stack pointer contents are adjusted automatically by the system. You are not going to write instructions for incrementing or decrementing the stack pointer. So it is not necessary always to use both the stack pointers. Just because we have MSP and PSP, we need not operate on both of them. Simple applications can rely purely on MSP alone. So the instructions for accessing stack memory are same, that is push and pop instruction. In the assembly language, you know, these instruction details and all we are going to study in the second module. We will see different data processing instructions. They come under that. Then push and pop are the instructions. What we write is push, and in the flower brackets, the register whose value has to be pushed into the memory. So push R0 means first R13. R13 is the stack pointer. R13 will be decremented by 4. R13 will be R13 minus 4. Then memory pointed by this R13 will be equal to R0. Okay, the memory pointed by R13 means whatever the contents you have in R13, it will be the address. It will be the address of the starting point of the stack pointer, of the starting point of the stack memory, right? So the memory pointed by that particular address will be the stack memory. So in that, you are loading the contents of R0. Okay, you are putting the contents of R0 into that particular memory. Then pop R0 means first the contents of memory are copied into the register. Register R0 will be whatever the contents of the memory pointed by that particular stack pointer, it will be copied into R0. And then the stack pointer is incremented by 4. Stack pointer is register R13. Then that will be incremented by 4. But remember that in push operation, first decrement and then push. Pop operation, first pop, then increment. Push and pop, they are usually used to save the register contents to stack, normally temporarily for saving the contents into the stack at the start of a subroutine. So when you are going to run a subroutine, that means a sub program, you are running some program, in between you have to go somewhere to other program, and later you are coming back. And in that case, temporarily is to store the contents of some registers, we are using this push and pop instructions. So push is done when you're moving out to a subroutine, and when you're coming back, you know, you do the pop and restore the registers from stack at the end of the subroutine, we do pop. So we can push or pop multiple registers. In case of Cortex-M3, we can push or pop multiple registers in one go, okay, in one instruction. Suppose you want to push different registers like R0 to R7, R0, R1, R2, R3, R4, R5, R6, R7, 8 registers, then R12, and R14, you can write them in a flower bracket in a single instruction like this. With a dash, R0 to R7 means all registers from R0 to R7, then R12 and R14, all are pushed. You do some operation here, okay? Then you want the registers back, then you can pop. In the same order, they will be popped, right? So then you can use this branch instruction. BX stands for branch. R14 is actually the link register. Okay, so this is a subroutine. We are running a subroutine, means from the main program you have gone to this subroutine. At the end, you have to go back to the main program, right? To go back to the main program, you use this link register. That is the next thing we are going to study, is link register. It will store the address of the next instruction. Whenever you are branching, the next instruction, wherever you have to go back, that instruction will be copied into R14. So after completing subroutine, you are going back to the main program. How do you know where to go? You know, that address will be there in R14, that is link register. So when you use this BX R14, it will go to that main program. I mean, wherever you had branched out, you will again continue from that particular thing. Okay. So instead of using R13, you can also write SP in the program codes. Instead of R13, you can write SP. It will indicate the current stack pointer. So because register push and pop operations are always word aligned, they are word aligned, means they are something which is divisible by 4. Okay, they are divisible by 4. Their addresses must be 0x0, 0x4, 0x8, something like that. They cannot have something like 1, 2, 3 or 5, 6, 7. They should be divisible by 4 because it's word aligned. Last two bits are always 0. Okay. And the SP or R13 bit 0 and 1 are hardwired to 0. Last two bits of our SP stack pointer are always 0 and always read as 0. RAZ stands for read as 0. That's because addresses where the stack memory starts, you know, they are always word aligned. The next kind of register we have is link register. Link register, you can also write it as LR or R14. Both can be used. Just like for stack pointer, you can use SP or R13. For link register, you can also write LR or R14. So it is used to store the return address. Whenever you use a subroutine or a function, after performing that subroutine or a function, you have to come back to the main program, right? So it will be used to store that return address where you are returning after executing that subroutine. So this is an example. This one was also an example. Here you can write BXLR also. So to that particular address you are returning. Here this is a main program. You have some instructions here. Here you are going to a subroutine, going to execute a subroutine whose name is function one. Here it is, right? So branch with link, BL stands for branch with link to function one. So from here you are going to this function one and you are storing the contents of next instruction, address of the next instruction in the link register. Address of the next instruction in the link register. And what will be the contents of the program counter? Program counter contents will be the address of the function or subroutine that you are going to execute, right? So it will go here, it will execute. At the end, you have to write this BXLR or BXR14 so that you are going to return to that particular place from where you had branched out, right? So this is how you use link register in branch instructions. So despite the fact that bit zero of the program counter is always zero, because instructions are word aligned or half word aligned, the LR bit zero is readable and writable. That means the bit zero of the link register can also be written, can change that value. This is because the thumb instruction, in the thumb instruction set, the bit zero is often used to indicate the arm or the thumb states. So you have to remember that bit zero is always used to indicate the whether it is an arm state or a thumb state to allow the thumb 2 program for the Cortex-M3 to work with other arm processors that support that thumb 2. This LSB is writable and readable. There is a option to read or write. You want to write this particular LSB of link register. Then there is another register, program counter. Program counter, you know, it is the address of the next instruction to be executed. That is there in the program counter. That is the current program address. The current program address will be there in the program counter. This register can be written to control the program flow. You can also write to this register, you know, if you want to go to a particular address, if you change the value of the program counter, the next instruction that is executed will be the instruction pointed by the address that is mentioned in the program counter. So again, for this program counter, you can use PC to access it or use R15 to access it. Because of the pipeline nature, there is one thing here, because of the pipeline nature of Cortex-M3, when you read this particular register, when you read the program counter, whatever the value you have, it will be different than the location of the presently executing instruction. Okay, that's why we say program counter has the address of the next instruction to be executed. Even though it is meant to be the current program address, I said the program counter will have the address of the next instruction to be executed. That is because of pipeline. Okay, that is because of pipeline. When the present instruction, for example, at 1000, the instruction that is executed is move R0, PC. Instruction, move R0, PC. PC is the program counter. That means you are copying the contents of program counter into R0. What you are expecting is PC will have 1000, because at present contents of 1000 is executed. You expect that R0 will be 1000. But by the time this is executed, you know, the next instruction is already fetched. The next instruction is already fetched. That means the next instruction will be at 1004. The program counter is already 1004 by the time this is executed. So actually what contents of R0 will be is 1004. The next after 1000, the next one will be 1004, because it is word aligned, right? It is 32-bit. That's why it will be in next. That will be 1004. So that way, program counter will actually have the address of the next instruction that is executed. So it will be, there is a difference of 4, because each instruction is 32-bit wide. So because an instruction address must be half word aligned, the LSB of the program counter read value is always 0. The bit 0 is always 0 in case of a program counter, because all instructions, they begin at an address ending with 0. However, when you go for branching, either by writing to PC or using branch instruction, the LSB of the target address should be set to 1. Okay, we have said that the LSB will indicate the state, whether it is ARM state or thumb state. So if it is 0, it will be in ARM state. If it is 1, it will be the thumb state. So since Cortex M3 operates in thumb state alone, okay, you have to remember that we are operating thumb state alone, that is thumb to state alone. There is no state switching in between ARM and thumb, right? So that LSB has to be forcibly made 1 before you copy that address into PC. If it is 0, it can imply trying to switch to the ARM state, and it will result in a fault exception in the Cortex M3. You cannot change the state to ARM in case of Cortex M3. You have to operate that in the thumb state only. So the LSB of the program counter should be made 1. Okay, while you copy that into the PC. So those are some things we need to take care while programming. These are certain registers what we have seen. R0 to R12 are general purpose registers. R13 is the stack pointer. R14 is the link register. R15 is the program counter. Apart from these registers, there are certain special registers in Cortex M3, like program status registers. We call them PSR, program status registers. Then interrupt mask registers, like pry mask, fault mask, and base pry. We will see all of this. Then the control register. So these registers have special functions, so they are called special registers, and they cannot be accessed by normal data processing instructions. So we require some special instructions for this, and they also cannot be used for normal data processing. So these are the special registers. PSR, there are different PSRs, that's why we call it XPSR. The X stands for one letter. There are three types, okay? So we will see the program status registers. Then interrupt mask registers, there are three again: pry mask, fault mask, and base pry. We will see them. We use them to mask the or disable the interrupts. Then the control register, it is used in selecting a particular operation mode. So these are the special registers. So these are the functions. PSR or XPSR provide arithmetic and logic processing flags. It's like the flags, whatever you have, that is indicated by PSR. They have the flag bits, zero flag and carry flag, execution status, and current executing interrupt number. They all are indicated by PSR. Then pry mask, fault mask, base pry, they are interrupt mask registers. Pry mask It is used to disable all the interrupts except non-maskable interrupt and hard fault. Except two interrupts, all the interrupts are disabled. Non-maskable interrupts, see in interrupts there are two types, maskable and non-maskable. Maskable interrupts are those which can be masked. Masked means what? If they occur, they can be ignored. Okay, system can ignore that. System will not at all recognize that interrupt. That is called maskable. Okay, if you mask them, they can be ignored. But non-maskable interrupts means if they occur, they have to be responded. You cannot ignore them. They are non-maskable interrupts. Then another type of exception is hard fault. If there is fault in the hardware, that is called hard fault. Except these two, all other interrupts will be masked. That is prime mask. Then fault mask, except non-maskable interrupts, all other things are disabled. Then base pry, it sets the priority level. Below a particular priority level, all other interrupts are disabled. That is by using base pry. Disable all interrupts of specific priority level or lower priority level. Then control register, it defines the privileged status and the stack pointer selection. Which one you are using among MSP or PSP and which access you are having, which privilege you are having. Based on that, you know, that is defined by this control register. As we have said, to access the special registers, we use special instructions. And those special instructions are MSR and MRS. They do not have memory addresses. MRS is copying the contents of special register into register. MSR is copying the contents of register into special register. If I write MRS, register, comma, special register. In register, I can use any of the registers, R0 to R12. Okay, any of them I can use, comma, special register, the name of the special register. It is used to read the special register. That is, the contents of special register is copied into a register. If I write MSR, you're writing into a special register. That is, contents of any register is copied into special register. Right? So this is the way we can use MSR and MRS to access this special registers. So we will see these special registers one by one. As I said, you know, there are three types. One is program status registers, interrupt mask registers, and control registers. In program status registers, again, there are three status registers. One is application program status register. Then there is interrupt program status register. Another one is execution program status register. There are three types. That's why we call them XPSR. If you address them collectively, all three, it is XPSR, or while using them in instruction, we just write PSR. Specifically, if you want to address any of these, you are going to write APSR, IPSR, and EPSR. These three, they can be accessed together or separately using MRS and MSR instructions. If you are using them together, you use this PSR. Otherwise, you use separately APSR, IPSR, or EPSR. You can also change the APSR using MSR. But EPSR and IPSR, you can only read. You cannot use EPSR and IPSR as destination. You cannot write into them. You can only read from them into certain register. This is an example of MRS instruction. You can see MRS, R0, comma, APSR. Here, you are reading the contents of APSR into R0. Contents of APSR is copied into R0. Here, contents of IPSR is copied into R0. And here, contents of EPSR is copied into R0. Similarly, you can use MSR, where contents of a register is copied into special register. This you can use only on APSR. You cannot do on IPSR and EPSR. So here what happens, contents of R0 is copied into APSR. To write the status of certain flags, you can use this MSR. So these are certain program status registers and their bits. You know, in Cortex-M3, these are the registers. There are three types. Okay. The five different flags are there. N stands for negative flag, Z stands for zero flag, C stands for carry flag, V is the overflow flag, and Q is the sticky saturation flag. Okay, sticky saturation flag. Negative means it indicates the number is negative, result is negative. Z indicates the result is zero. C indicates there is a carry after a certain operation. V indicates there is an overflow. Q indicates there is sticky saturation. That means it has gone to saturation. The signal level has gone to saturation. Then IPSR is for interrupt program status register. It is an 8-bit. 8 bits will indicate the interrupt. Okay, so we say there are indicates exception the processor is handling. There are, it can handle up to 240 interrupts, right? So at least 8 bits are required. So for that you have this 8 bit as exception number. Each one is having a particular number. Each type of exception is having a particular number. So that will be indicated in this particular 8 bits from 0 to 8, okay. 9 bits actually, 0 to 8. Then EPSR is for execution program status register. Then there are two things here, ICI or IT and T. ICI stands for interrupt continuable instruction bits. If then instruction status bit, okay. T is the thumb state. It is always one because we are operating in thumb state. If you try to make this zero, you will cause a fault exception, an exception. ICI IT indicates interrupt continuable instruction bits. If then instruction status bit, okay. Then this was in the, yeah, this is in the, if you combine all these, okay, it's a 32 bit register. PSR is a 32-bit register. Bit number 0 to 8 is exception number. 10 to 15 is ICIIT. Again, 25 to 16 is ICIIT. Bit number 24 is the thumb bit. It is 1 always. And 27 to 31 indicates different flags. Collectively, if you want to address this entire register, you can use PSR, MRS, R0, PSR, or MSR, PSR, R0. To read or write from PSR into PSR. Then different fields, right? N for negative, Z for zero, C for carry or borrow. Carry in case of addition, borrow in case of subtraction, V for overflow, Q for sticky saturation. These are different flags. ICN, IT and T, they are in interrupt PSR, exception, ICI, ITN and T, they are for execution PSR. Exception number is in the interrupt PSR. So these are different fields of program status registers. So if you compare this with the traditional ARM processor, program status register in the traditional ARM processor, there are some changes, some fields have actually gone. The mode bit field is gone now, because the Cortex-M3 does not have operation mode as defined in ARM 7. This mode M is gone. We do not use this in our Cortex-M3. Then thumb bit is moved to bit 24. Thumb bit was bit 5. That is moved to bit 24. Then interrupt status, I and F, what you can find here, this is not there in our Cortex-M3. They are replaced by new interrupt mask registers, prime mask, which are separated from PSR. That is, interrupt mask registers are separated from PSR. This is current program status register in traditional ARM processors, which are different from Cortex-M3 processors. The next type of special registers are interrupt mask registers. As you can see, there are three different registers here, prime mask, fault mask and base pry. The pry mask and base pry, they are useful for temporarily disabling certain interrupts in timing critical tasks. So why you have to disable interrupts is when interrupts occur, the presently executing task will be stopped or it will be kept on hold, and the interrupted thing will be serviced first and then you are returning. But when you are executing certain time critical applications, in real time applications, if some interrupts keep happening, you know, you will not be executing the task within that particular time constraint. You will not be satisfying the time constraints required by the real time tasks. So in that case, we will have to disable certain interrupts. Okay. So for disabling those things, disabling the interrupts, we are using prime mask and base pry registers. Then fault mask, it is also to temporarily disable fault handling when a task has crashed. In fault mask, you are disabling all the interrupts except non-maskable interrupts, right? Even hard fault. So in this scenario, a number of different faults might be taking place when a task crashes. So once the core starts cleaning up, it might not want to be interrupted by other faults caused by the crash process, right? So it will be, if you allow all the interrupts, it will be, you will be interrupted too many times in between. In that case, you'll have to disable the fault handling whenever a task has crashed. Therefore, the fault mask, it gives the OS kernel the time to deal with the fault conditions, right? So these are certain interrupt mask registers. As you can see here, prime mask, it is a 1-bit register. When this is set, it allows non-maskable interrupt and the hard fault exception. All other interrupts and exceptions are masked. If it is 1, that means all interrupts, except NMI, that is non-maskable interrupt, and hard fault. They are all other, except them, all are masked. The default value is zero. That means no masking is set. If you make it one, then all interrupts except NMI and hard fault are masked. Fault mask, it is also a one bit. If it is set, it allows only the NMI, and all interrupts and fault handling exceptions are disabled. Okay, so it allows only the NMI, only non-maskable interrupt will be allowed, and all other interrupts, including fault handling exception, they are all disabled. They are all masked. By default, it will be zero. That means there is no masking. No masking is set. Then there is base PRY. It is a register of up to 8 bits, depending on the bit width implemented for priority level. So up to 8 bits it can have. This defines the masking priority level. When this is set, that means you set it to a particular value, it disables all the interrupts of the same or lower level. Lower level means which has got larger priority value. That means priority 1, it is a lower level. Okay, priority 4 means it is priority 1. You know, if you set priority 1, that means it has got the highest priority. Okay, priority 2 is the next priority than 1. Priority 3 means it is lower priority. So priority 0 is the highest priority. So when this is set, it disables all interrupts of the same or lower level. So the higher priority interrupts can still be allowed. So suppose this value of base PRY is 4. That means all the interrupts with priority 4 and lower, they will be disabled. But interrupts of priority 0, 1, 2, 3, they are allowed. If the value of base PRY is 4, that means all interrupts of 4 and below, they are disabled. But interrupts of 0, 1, 2, 3, they are allowed. If it is 10, from 0 to 9, it is allowed. 10 and above, it is disabled. That way. Okay. So if this is set to 0, the masking function is disabled. That is by default, it will be 0. That means all interrupts are allowed when it is 0. If you are setting it to a particular value, then below that same value and below that, all interrupts will be disabled. To access this, different functions are available in the device driver libraries, which are provided by the microcontroller vendors, by different vendors for different types of microcontrollers. We can use different functions. Okay, for example, get and set are the get and set instructions. This is in case of C language. When you use, if you want to read the contents of any of this, you can use get instruction. If you write x is equal to underscore underscore get underscore base PRY, right, like this, the contents of this base PRY will be copied into the variable x. Similarly, you can use that for PRY mask and fault mask. If you want to set some value into these registers, you can use set PRY base PRY in the brackets. If you write that value, whatever you want to set, you know, that will be loaded into that particular register. Set base PRY x, if you write base PRY 4, you know, base PRY register will become 4. Set PRY mask, it can be either 0 or 1. It is a 1 bit register, PRY mask. If you write 0, PRY mask will be 0. If you write 1, PRY mask will be 1. Similarly, fault mask, it can be 0 or 1. Then you can even use enable and disable IRQ, interrupt request. Disable IRQ means interrupt request. It is used to clear the PRY mask. If PRY mask register is cleared, you are actually enabling the interrupt request. You are enabling interrupt requests, right? If it is 0, by default, it will be 0. All the interrupts are enabled. If you are making it 1, if you are setting PRY mask by using enable IRQ, it's like disabling interrupt requests. You are going to disable the interrupt request by making PRY mask as 1, right? So these are the way you can access these interrupt mask registers. You can also access them using MRS and MSR in assembly language. In assembly language, MRS is used to read the contents of this special register into a register by using MRS, R0, base PRY. Contents of base PRY is loaded into R0. Similarly, you can use them for PRY mask and fault mask. If you use MSR, you are going to write certain content registers into base PRY. You write MSR, base PRY, R0, contents of R0 is copied into base PRY. Similarly, for PRY mask and fault mask, you can use. Okay, so you cannot set these particular things. You cannot use MSR in the user access level. You have to go to the privileged access level only to set the contents of PRY mask, fault mask, and base PRY registers. Then the last type of the special register we have is the control register. This control register is used to define the privilege level and also to select the SP, select whether it is MSP or PSP, main stack pointer or process stack pointer. So this control register is of 2 bits. It has got 2 bits, control bit 0 and control bit 1. Control bit 1 is used to indicate the stack, whether it is main stack or process stack. Okay, if that control bit 1 is 1, it means we are using the alternate stack. Alternate stack is actually the process stack, because default stack is the main stack. When you are using main stack or the main stack pointer, control bit 1 is 0. When you are using process stack pointer, control bit 1 is equal to 1. So it indicates which stack pointer is being used, whether it is main stack pointer or process stack pointer. If it is 0, main stack pointer is used. If it is 1, process stack pointer is used. Again, there can be 2 levels. If it is in the thread level, if it is in thread or the base level, the alternate stack is the PSP. So if it is in the handler mode, there is no alternate stack. So this bit must be 0 when the processor is in handler mode. There are 2 modes actually, thread mode and handler mode. In thread mode, it can be the alternate stack is PSP. If it is, that means it will be 1. If it is in the handler mode, it is always the main stack pointer. If it is in the handler mode, there is only 0. Control bit 1 is always 0. Then control bit 0 is used to indicate the privileged level. If it is 0, it is the privileged state in the thread mode. If it is 1, it is the user state in the thread mode. If it is in handler mode, the processor operates in privileged mode only. Okay, a thread mode can have 2 states, privileged and user level. Okay, privileged and user state. Whereas in the handler mode, there can be only privileged mode only. Right, so we will understand this when you go to the operation modes. Right, so in the next class, we will see that operation modes. For now, you remember control bit 1 indicates whether it is main stack pointer or process stack pointer. If it is 0, it is main stack pointer. If it is 1, it is process stack pointer. Control bit 0 indicates whether it is privileged access level or user access level. If it is 0, it is privileged access level. If it is 1, it is user access level. So yeah, the control bit 1 in Cortex M3, the control bit 1 is always 0 in handler mode. There are 2 modes, as I said, thread mode and handler mode. If it is handler mode, it is always 0. However, in thread mode, it can be either 0 or 1. This bit is writable only when it is in thread mode and privileged access level. In the user state or handler mode, you cannot write to this bit, because it should always be 0. Because it is always 0 because it is a handler mode. Aside from writing to this register, another way to change this bit is to change bit 2 of the LR when in exception return. If you change bit 2, it will be the same as control 1, control bit 1. If you write to that, it's like writing to this control bit 1. And control bit 0 is writable again only in a privileged state. Once it enters the user states, the only way to switch back to the privileged state is to trigger an interrupt. You cannot change this control bit to change from user to privileged state. So once it enters user state, if you want to go back to privileged state, you have to trigger an interrupt and change this in the exception handler. To access the control register in C, there are certain instructions in CMSIS. You know, there is a standard for Cortex microcontroller software interface standard. We call it CMSIS. In that, to access the control register, we have certain functions. Again, that is get and set. To read the control register, we can use x is equal to get control. And to write into the control register, you can use set control. These are actually the instructions in CMSIS library. Set control in the brackets, if you write x, whatever the value x is there, it will be copied into the control register. Again, using assembly, if you want to read or write, you can use MRS and MSR. MRS is to read the control register into register. You can use any register, R0, R1, or any register. And MSR is to write the value of any register into the control register, right? So these are different things or different registers that we have seen today. We have seen the architecture of Cortex M3, different features of it. Then we have gone in detail with the registers. There are general purpose registers, R0 to R12, stack pointer R13, link register R14, and program pointer R15. And there are certain special registers. program status registers, that APSR, application program status registers, IPSR, interrupt program status register, and EPSR, execution program status registers. And there are interrupt mask registers, base pry, fault mask, and pry mask, and control registers, which is a 2-bit control 0 and control 1. It is used to define the access level or the privilege level and the to select the stack mount, right? In the next class, we will see what are the different operation modes and the privilege levels. And also, we will see certain other things in the architecture of Cortex M3.